Hi, welcome to another episode of Northwest Outdoors. I'm producer Rick Spencer, and on this show, we're going to head to the San Juan Islands to do a little kayaking. There, we discover that kayaking is one of the most popular outdoor recreations in the northwest corner of Washington State. From there, we head to Tumac Mountain in south central Washington to do a day hike. So sit back and enjoy your Northwest Outdoors. Funding of Northwest Outdoors is made possible in part by O'Loughlin Sports Shows. Puyallup, Portland, and the Redmond Sports Shows are proud supporters of public television throughout the Northwest, placing an emphasis on education for the great outdoors. By Kershaw Knives of Portland, Oregon. Makers of precision tools and cutlery, Kershaw Knives continues to support outdoor programming and outdoor activities throughout the Pacific Northwest. And by Northwest Dock Systems of Eatonville, Washington. Manufacturers of Herbs pontoon boats, Northwest Dock Systems supports safe and environmentally responsible enjoyment of the outdoors.
Drake, winds southerly 10 to 15 knots, a few clouds, outlook light to moderate southwesterly.
We're in the San Juan Islands near Friday Harbor, Washington. It is mid-morning as a number of adventurers get ready to go sea kayaking. Northwest Outdoors met up with SeaQuest Expeditions to get a closer look at the sport of sea kayaking in the northwestern corner of Washington State. SeaQuest is one of a number of outfits designed to explore this area and teach visitors about the delicate ecosystem here. Kayak guides Andrea Iverson and Chad Norman have a lot of responsibility. They have the job of making a newcomer feel comfortable in their boat before heading out to sea.
These are your spray skirts. This is what will keep your hull dry and will keep your lap dry, which is essential. So, they're very easy. They fit just like a pair of suspenders. One size fits all. When you paddle, all you need to submerge is the white part of your blade. If you submerge any more than the white part of your blade, you're sinking it too deep, okay? Your shoulders should turn. When your shoulders are turning, your shoulders are working, and your shoulders are the strongest part of your upper body. Okay, here's the anatomy of a boat. The front is always the bow. The rear is always the stern. The left is the port, and the starboard is on the right side, okay? These are your hatches. This is where you place your gear. The key to kayaking, to entering a kayak, is to keep your center of gravity low.
Paddles in hand. Make sure that when you get deep enough, drop your rudder and seal your skirts.
We're on the islands now. Who's ever heard of island time? Watches are kind of out the window, okay? From this point on, we go with the flow. We go with the currents. We go with the wind, okay? So sometimes we may sit on a beach for an hour, waiting for the tides to turn. We may sit on the beach for 2 hours waiting for the wind to slow down. This is island time. Let's go with the flow, all right? I'll give you a time in the morning to wake up. From that point on, we go with the wind and the water, okay? It's all about going with the flow.
The San Juans consist of approximately 400 islands and rocks that are visible at high tide. About 175 of them have gotten official names over the years. On our SeaQuest expeditions, we usually paddle somewhere between 8 and 12 miles a day. That is on the camping trips. The day trips, we usually go about 5 to 7 miles, mostly because of time limits. 8 to 12 miles is equal to about 4 to 6 hours of paddling, and that's broken up with frequent rest stops on beaches along the route, stopping for stretches and opportunities to eat lunch and do some tide pooling.
Mark Lewis came along on the trip. He founded this company a number of years ago after being a kayak guide himself.
Well, we started SeaQuest Expeditions as a way of leading kayak trips that had an educational component to them. I had been working as a kayak guide for other outfitters, and you know, the primary goal was to have fun and learn about sea kayaking, but the educational side was missing, and I realized that we really needed to add in a message about the environment, make people appreciate what we have out here, and hopefully become better stewards with better knowledge, learn more about wildlife. There's a lot of joy just in experiencing wildlife and learning about its ways of surviving. And you know, all of our guides are either biologists or environmental scientists. They're excellent educators. They're great at teaching not only the skills of sea kayaking, but also teaching about the marine environment here.
This is bull kelp, and you've been seeing this along the way. It can grow to be about 50 to 60 feet. It is filled with carbon dioxide, which helps it to float. What happens is it provides a great habitat for small animals like small fish, and those small fish attract larger fish like the salmon. And when the salmon come running through, that's what attracts the orcas. This is edible. It's used in a lot of cosmetics and food processes. It's a gelling agent. And if you guys want, you can take a small piece from the frond on the bottom, pinch it off with your fingernail, and take a bite. It's kind of salty, but it's pretty good.
Kayaking is a very peaceful way to enjoy the water. It allows you to better appreciate the more subtle qualities of nature. And when you are more quiet and you can listen, then the environment begins to take on many more dimensions than you get from a powerboat or some other ways you can enjoy the water. So kayaking is just almost a much deeper way to enjoy the ocean and sea. I think people have an image of the Northwest as being a kind of a wilderness wonderland, and the Northwest is such a great combination of mountains and ocean, and what better way to enjoy both than to be on the water.
What I like to do is hit the National Wildlife Refuges on the way to, say, we're doing a three-day trip, we're going to Stewart Island. I know a couple National Wildlife Refuges, which are seal haulouts. There's 84 in the archipelago, so there's various seal haulouts. We saw quite a few seal pups, and we saw 24 seals on one, and I like to check out the seals. Also, taking time just to float while we're traveling. Kayaking's very meditative. It's very, when you paddle, it's just that little sound of the paddle going into the water and you're gliding around, there's no noise. Great way to see wildlife, great way to bring all the comforts of home with you as well. You can go out for extended trips. Very, very relaxing.
What everyone's looking at is feather duster worms. We're also looking at plumos anemones, which are big white frilly anemones that get up to about 3 feet long. We also have some mussels that are living here on the dock as well. And they filter through about 100 gallons of water a day.
The San Juan Islands are a very complicated geological structure. There's over 40 different bedrock formations in this tiny little area. Geologists call it a melange formation because it's such a strange mixture of bedrocks. After they were all pushed together by movements of the Earth's crust, the glaciers ran through this region at least 17 different times. At some points, the San Juan Islands were buried in a sheet of ice that was up to 2 miles thick. And they carved out all the waterways and the beautiful coves. Basically, these are fjords that we travel through in our kayaks. The depths can reach in excess of 1,000 feet. Right now, the San Juan Islands are in the process of rebounding from the weight of the glaciers. Now that that tremendous mass has been lifted from the islands, they've been slowly rising up at a rate of sometimes as much as an inch a year. So they've risen several hundred feet since the last glaciers melted away. The last of the glaciers did melt only about 12,000 years ago, so all the forests and wildlife that you see here now have colonized in the past 12,000 years. Right now the climate, although we're surrounded by regions of rainforests that receive up to 200 inches of rainfall annually, here in the San Juan Islands we receive only about a tenth of that. In fact, just on the other side of this cove you can find a native species of prickly pear cactus growing. Right below trees, the same species of trees that you would find growing in the rainforest. So it's an interesting assemblage of plants and animals that live here, not only because of the nice moist and temperate maritime climate that we have, but also because of our position in the rain shadow cast by the Olympic Mountains. We'll have species that you would think of more in terms of desert-like regions or eastern Washington.
Good job, everyone. We can put our PFDs and spray skirts in our boat and take a little tour of the island. Shell and Barnacle Beach, it's our little tropical oasis in the San Juan Islands here. On a sunny day, the water's all bluish green and there's no wind here. It's very nice. Why don't we start walking and see what we can find on the way? Got a lot of little acorn barnacles through here. The rock I wanted to show you, it shows you a good layer. Here's the conglomerate layer and the sandstone layer. There's the white flowers through here are yarrow. And we had a couple of these on Posia. Up here is gumweed. We'll walk down here, see if there's any of the tide pools left for us. You can see all of them running around in here. There's a bunch of tide pool sculpins in here, right there. There's another one. They all hid when I came over here. They all went, those little tide pool sculpins. There's one right here. They look like little tadpoles. And if you guys look a little closer here, we have an aggregate anemone here, right here. And if you touch them, they have little stingers that they sting their prey on, but they're so small that we can't feel them. But if you use like a part of your body, like your tongue, you would feel it. It would poke you. We have a wrinkled whelk in here too. This little cone, like long snail looking thing. Right here, speckled limpet. This is sea lettuce here. It's actually edible. This brown is sea moss. These are shore crabs. They'll get about like this big, about as big as a medium or small size rock crab. Looking for a male. Mark found him. Purple shore crabs can be green, and the way you can tell the difference is there's spots on their front of their little. See, this guy has spots, but the green one doesn't. But the green one can be a purple or a brown as well. So you just look at the front here and tell whether they have spots or not. When we take wildlife out of the tide pools, we always want to put it back right where we found it, just to help them out. Here's the difference between a male and a female. Female has this round half circle. There's another one, big one. This is where she stores her eggs. And this is a male here, kind of a phallic little symbol there on the crab. And that's how you can tell the difference between a male and a female. This is a Rocky Mountain juniper. This is actually a very old tree. It's been gnarled here from the wind and the weather. Rocky Mountain junipers are primarily found in rain shadows. We're right now in the rain shadow of the Olympic Mountains, which actually a couple peaks are peeking out over there underneath the clouds, the Olympic Mountains. And so since we're in a rain shadow, it's got the perfect climate for the Rocky Mountain juniper here.
Yeah, here's the otter trail going into the brush. They can get through some pretty low spots.
There are a few simple things to remember if you would like to try the sport of sea kayaking. Always dress warmly. Dress for the swim you might have to take. Be prepared by dressing in layers, and always bring an extra layer of clothing. Bring lots of water to drink and stay hydrated at all times. You should hydrate yourself to the bursting point. Make sure to bring sunblock and a hat and wear them both. You can always pick your paddling environment from calm, peaceful bird watching to whitewater adrenaline thrills. Sea kayaking is for anyone and everyone. If you come across an injured animal, don't try to help it. Contact an animal rehabilitation center to rescue the animal. The Northwest has a number of such centers. The Friday Harbor Rehab Center for Animals is one such facility. Closed to public viewing, this center administers care for a number of species.
We handle a wide range of different species, somewhere around 75% birds, 25% mammals, everything from little hummingbirds to eagles, hawks, owls, great blue herons, and from an occasional little mouse to harbor seal pups, deer, raccoons, so a wide range of different species. I think we have about 180 species on our treated list so far. So.
Shona Adkin is the education coordinator for the Wolf Hollow Wildlife Rehabilitation Center in Friday Harbor.
Well, we feel it's important to have a rehab center in any area because what we do is we treat animals that need care as a result of human activities. So when you have a lot of people in an area, you have animals hit by cars, attacked by domestic pets like, you know, cats and dogs, flying into power lines, getting tangled in fences, fishing line, fishing net. So when the human population in an area increases, you tend to have more of these problems for wildlife. And we feel our job is to give them a second chance, you know, treat the injuries or problems caused by human beings. We take care of injured, orphaned, and sick native wild animals with the aim of releasing them back into the wild again. In general, rehab centres get calls from the public about they have seen an injured animal or a youngster that they think has been left by its parents. And when they call, we give them information and give them suggestions on how to tell if this is a natural occurrence or this animal needs care. And if it does, then we make arrangements to get the animal to us. And that would be different for different centres. Wolf Hollow takes animals from all of the San Juan Islands, plus a part of the adjacent mainland, Anacortes, Mount Vernon, Cedar Woolley, basically the Skagit Valley area. So we get them from quite a distance, and we treat somewhere between 500 and 550 animals a year. One of the animals that we care for each year, and right now in July, is one of the main animals that we're caring for, are harbor seal pups. And these are our youngsters that have become separated from their mother. Some of them are injured, mostly they're starved and dehydrated. And we are caring for them until they are old enough and strong enough to go back out into the wild again. So they go through a variety of stages from being tube fed a special formula to learning to eat fish, to learning to eat live fish. And then we keep them until they are about weaning weight, and then we tag them and release them back into the wild again. If someone finds an injured or perhaps orphaned or separated youngster, what we suggest is that they call us first and talk about it, because sometimes people think an animal needs rescued, especially a youngster.
In this segment, we are on a day hike in the William O. Douglas Wilderness area deep in the Wenatchee National Forest. The 166,000 acres that make up this wilderness area is located between Highway 12 and Highway 410 in the southern Washington Cascade Mountains. This area is named for the late U.S. Supreme Court Justice William O. Douglas and was designated as a wilderness area in 1984. We are on the Pacific Crest National Scenic Trail, which runs 27 miles through the wilderness. We join day hikers Herb Schmidt and a group of friends for a hike to Tumac Mountain. This area is made up of high elevation lakes, pine forests, and alpine peaks.
When hikers go up the trails in the Pacific Northwest, they might be interested in knowing some of the facts of the forest. This particular tree here is a red cedar. You can see by the red bark. Native Americans valued this tree extensively, particularly on the west side of the mountains, because they were able to strip off the bark and weave their baskets, and they made rain jackets and rain hats out of it. It, to them, was a very valuable tree. It has been very important over the ages. Hikers might also like to know about the alpines in the forest. This is an alpine fir. Some people use them for Christmas trees. Notice that it's layered as it goes up. I have an altimeter here on my watch, and it says 5160. It's probably slightly lower than that. But that's when you start seeing the alpines in this particular altitude.
Gotta stop by and have a dip there. Looks kind of really refreshing today. Hey Herb, look, there's Tumac.
That's up about, 6,200, 6,300 feet?
6,340 according to my green trail map that I bought this last week.
That's great.
I might just add one thing. This Tumac Mountain that we're approaching here is the youngest volcano in the whole Northwest. This is only 10,000 years old.
Well, it's really a cinder cone, isn't it?
It's really a cinder cone. And we're going to be sitting up there having lunch before we can turn around.
I was doing some calculations, and that's about 100,000 lives if you all live till 100 years old. That's not too likely, but so it's been there a while. When you're hiking on trails like this, and particularly in the fall when you see all the colors and the low sun is coming in and reflecting against the waterways, and it's just something that you just have to appreciate.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, it's a...
To keep this sort of thing.
You bet.
It's just priceless.
Otherwise, it won't be there for generations to come.
It won't be there for the great-grandchildren. Perched right on top of Tumac. Look where you started from, way down there at Twin Sisters, 2 miles away. And look what you can see now. Way, way off there's Stewart. Then there's Aches and Bismarck. Look over here is Ironstone, where we've been many times, and McNeil, Shell Rock. Below us, Blankenship Meadows. But look on this side. Pretty soon we'll be over there on the old ski lift. And look at Goat Rocks to the south, and Adams, and way over here, the base of Helens. Man, I say this is a view. Aren't you glad you came up?
Well, did you guys have a good lunch today?
Oh, we had a great lunch, and how could you not have up on top of this mountain? Yeah, we've got, 4 miles to go back?
3 miles. 3 miles to go back.
The hike to Tumac Mountain is accessible by the Twin Sisters Trailhead in the William O. Douglas Wilderness area of south-central Washington State. It is a good 7 mile hike round trip with an elevation gain of 2,100 feet. But the view for lunch is worth it.
It's been just a really great day, hasn't it?
Oh, marvelous.
Go online with Northwest Outdoors and learn more about sea kayaking in the San Juans or hiking in the Wenatchee National Forest. Click on www.northwestoutdoors.org.
Yeah.
Funding of Northwest Outdoors is made possible in part by O'Loughlin Sports Shows. Puyallup, Portland, and the Redmond Sports Shows are proud supporters of public television throughout the Northwest, placing an emphasis on education for the great outdoors. By Kershaw Knives of Portland, Oregon. Makers of precision tools and cutlery, Kershaw Knives continues to support outdoor programming and outdoor activities throughout the Pacific Northwest. And by Northwest Dock Systems of Eatonville, Washington. Manufacturers of Herbs pontoon boats, Northwest Dock Systems supports safe and environmentally responsible enjoyment of the outdoors.